What does a 2,000-year-old Greek bloke, a Belgian scientist, African drumming, and never making a boring rhythm again have in common? The answer lies in what are known as Euclidean rhythms. So let's listen to an idea that's not using Euclidean rhythms, and then listen to a version of the same idea that is employing this ancient algorithm. Going to explain to you exactly what a Euclidean rhythm is, where it comes from, why it's so powerful, and how you can use it in your music to never have a boring rhythm again. So firstly, let's touch upon a bit of history so we can understand what this is and where it comes from. Well, it starts over 2,000 years ago with an ancient Greek bloke named Euclid. He was a mathematician and is considered the father of geometry. He loved numbers, absolutely loved them, couldn't get enough, and he developed an algorithm for determining the greatest common divisor of two numbers. I was rubbish at maths at school, so if you're anything like me, this took my head a little bit of time to get around. But simply said, a divisor is when you can divide one whole number by another whole number and it equals a whole number. For example, 8 divided by 2 equals 4, so 2 is a divisor of 8 because 4 is a whole number as well, but 8 divided by 3 equals 2.666 recurring, which isn't a whole number, which means that 3 isn't a divisor of 8, whereas 2 is. Now you might wonder to the relevance of all this maths, but it's going to make sense in a few minutes when we get to the music. Anyway, fast forward over 2,000 years, and a guy named Erik Bjorklund used that principle that Euclid discovered and applied it to the timing of events in a neutron accelerator. Now just a couple of years after that, a Belgian guy named Godfried Toussaint realized the same pattern that Bjorklund had created appears throughout music across multiple cultures and across multiple centuries. It really was a bit of a matrix moment. So first I'm going to open up a couple of really quick diagrams that are going to make it more sense, and then we're going to jump into Ableton as well. So forgive my drawing skills, but you can see here we've got a circle, and each of these black notes is a kick drum. And this just loops around 1, 2, 3, 4, so it sounds like this. Now, if we want to play 3 claps within that same time period and want them evenly spaced, it's going to look and sound something like this. And that's technically a polyrhythm. So there's an even space of time between each of these claps, spread over the same amount of time it takes to play those 4 kicks. And in a linear piano roll editor type approach, it's going to look something like this. So you've got kick, 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 and then it loops around. And with those 3 claps back in, it's going to sound and look like this. And then loop around there. So same example, but in linear format instead of showing it in a circle. Now this is where it gets really interesting and the power of Euclid rhythms start to show. If we now divide that time into a resolution or a certain grid, then you can see these claps are falling outside of the grid. So I've just divided this into 8 sections. We can call this grid the number of steps. So there are 8 steps here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And we can call the hits or notes that are playing events. So we've got steps and events. Now, a Euclidean rhythm will seek to balance out the events across a sequence in the most efficient way. So with that in mind, the Euclidean version of this rhythm is going to look something more like this. And you can see these claps have to fit within that sequence of steps. So the distance between all 3 claps isn't the same, it's just as balanced as it can get with the resolution of the grid or the steps that we've assigned. And this rhythm is going to sound like this. Now, if we choose our steps to be 16 instead of 8, it's going to look more like this. Now, these 3 steps aren't as balanced as they could be within this resolution. So a Euclidean rhythm is going to change it to be something more like this. And that's because in this example, you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 steps between the first and the second clap. Then you've got 1, 2, 3, 4 steps. And then you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 steps before the next clap. Now we know that that can be more balanced at that resolution, and that's why it's going to move it to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 steps, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 steps. And that's as balanced as it can be. Think of it this way. If you had a roulette table and a bunch of marbles, say 16 of them, and that roulette table was balanced on a stick, to keep the balance of the table, you'd want to distribute those marbles as evenly as possible within the pockets available on the roulette table. If you didn't, it's going to lose balance and fall off. Bit of a weird analogy, I know, but hopefully it helps explain it. So now I want to go into Ableton and show you what you can do with the Euclidean sequencer and the interest and power you can create in your rhythms. Okay, so let's start off with the example that we've just looked at. We've got four kick drums and our grid is split into 16. So we've got 16 steps and 4 events. Now, as 4 is perfectly divisible into 16, they're all an equal distance apart. Now let's create a baseline, and we're going to use this Euclidean Sequencer Pro, which is available for Macs for Live, to create that baseline. And I'm going to show you what these 3 controls do. So in a Euclidean rhythm, you've got 3 main parameters. We've already looked at 2 of them: the resolution of your sequence, or the amount of steps, the number of events that occur within those steps, and this third parameter is rotation. And all the rotation does is change the start point of the sequence. The relationship between the notes within the sequence remain the same. So in this example, we've got a bass note, and currently there are 16 steps, 4 events, so it should be hitting exactly the same as the kick. Which doesn't make for a very good bass line. So what we can do is we can actually change the rotation, and if you look, these notes are just going to start in a different place. So if we rotate it once, twice, it's now going to be playing exactly in between each kick. So that sounds better. And that's all rotation is. So you can see we could start it on the third resolution of that step instead. But I like starting in the second place. So the two relates to the amount of steps it's pushing that sequence forwards by. Okay, nice and simple. Now I want to show you what happens when you start adding multiple Euclidean rhythms over the top of each other. So if we go to this synth here, and let's just activate it, I'm going to turn off the second one, and we've just got the first. So let's see what's going on here. We've got 16 steps, lovely. We've got 3 events occurring within those steps. I've got it set to rotation 16 at the moment, but it doesn't really matter. I mean, you can experiment where you want that sequence to start. But always there's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 notes in between these two events, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 steps in between these two events, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 steps between these two events. So let's just have a listen to that with the bass line and the kick. So you've got this really cool syncopated rhythm already occurring. Now we've got 5 events, as evenly balanced as possible, and this is going to be a good way to show you how it actually balances it. So if we add more events, like 7 for instance, you can see here we've got let's put this back to the 0 position. We've got an event, 1 space, an event, 1 space, event, 1 space, event. Then you've got 2 spaces, event, 1 space, event, 1 space, event, 2 spaces, event. And that's the most balanced way, using that Euclidean algorithm, that these events can be balanced across this amount of steps, or this resolution of steps. So hopefully you can start to hear the fun that you can have using these Euclidean rhythms. So let's add a second one over the top. So now we've got 10 events occurring within 16, and you can see how it's balanced. It's these green ones now. So we've got a space, event, event, space, event, event, space, event, space, event, event. And now you've got this really cool groove going on. So let's add another one. But what we're going to do now is create a different resolution, or choose a different amount of steps. And this is going to start to create a polymeter, which will ebb and flow and change over time. I'm going to share with you a video on polymeters at the end of this video, but check this out. We've got 1 event occurring every 12 steps, so it doesn't sound very interesting. So let's just add 5 events occurring every 12 steps, and then change the rotation a bit. And now let's have a listen to it. Going to change the note, see if I can find something that sounds better. So you can see these are spinning at different times, these kind of clock hands. And if we choose, I don't know, 17 steps and 10 events. Let's see what happens. Could sound rubbish, but it's all about experimentation with it. Let's add that up an octave. A really interesting rhythm. Now, this is where it can be applied to drums as well. And this is common, as Toussaint discovered, in a lot of music from all around the world. So African clap drumming, stuff from Turkey, stuff from Canada, stuff from all over the world, literally in multiple cultures, using these different Euclidean rhythms that will balance a certain amount of events or hits across a certain amount of steps. So we're just harnessing what already exists using these matrix skills. So now let's load in some drums into a drum rack. I've just loaded in some random ones, a clap, a clave, a little side stick, and a nice 909 rim shot or 808 rim shot. So now I've put one of these Euclidean sequences on there as well. I'm just gonna activate the first one, 16 steps, 4 events, rotation 14, I don't like how that sounds. So let's just put this clap where you would expect a normal clap to be. So we could work that out. You've got 4 events in the 16 steps, and we want it to be on every other kick, which means we'd have to choose 2 events within those 16 steps, like so, and then make them hit on every other kick, like so. So now we should have a normal kick, clap, as you can hear. So now let's start adding in some of these other sounds. Ten steps, 1 event on that clave. Again, when you start using a different amount of steps for the different Euclidean rhythms, that's when you start running into polymeters. Now let's add a third Euclidean rhythm on these drums. Now it's the side stick. So I'm going to put all of this together and create something right now using just Euclidean rhythms. I'll put some chords in there as well, and you can hear what we can create using these Euclidean rhythms, which I think are absolutely awesome. So now you know about Euclidean rhythms and how to use them to make your own interesting rhythms. But you may remember I mentioned polyrhythms and polymeters in this video as well. Now these are the two other keys to the holy trinity of creating rhythms. And with all three of these techniques, you will never make a boring rhythm again unless you choose to. So make sure you watch this video to learn all about how to use polymeters and polyrhythms to give you all the skills you need to never make a boring rhythm again. But before you do that, if you enjoyed this video, please like it and subscribe to my channel. Really helps me out, and I will catch you over at this next video.